Choosing faith and hope instead of fear and anxiety. You can sit in church, you have chosen fear and anxiety. The fact that they show you a lab report does not mean you should die. God will do everything also for you believe him to do. So if you don't believe God is going to do it, stay out of it. Your case is different. You have another source. There is a God you serve. If it happened to others, it cannot happen to me. This is the confidence we have in him. When we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Amen.
Amen.
My confidence in praying is that if God will not answer prayer, he will not ask us to pray. Put your hands together for Jesus. Amen. So anytime you kneel down, go on your knees, or you bow your head to pray, have that assurance that there is a God in heaven that answers prayer. He may delay, but he's working at it.
Amen.
Yeah. It is God who is at work in me, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So he's working at it. Amen. There are some prayers I prayed 20 years ago. It's now God is answering it.
It's working. It's working.
It's working. Hallelujah. Amen. That's the place you come to and say, I'm not even praying, but things are just happening. Amen.
Amen.
He's faithful.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I heard one man of God say something, it strike me. He said, don't go to a church that they sing more than they pray.
Amen.
He shook me from my bed. Hallelujah. 1 hour singing, 10 minutes prayer. They can Oku will sing. They can Cracker will sing. Everybody will be singing. A man of God said it and I heard it. He says it's dangerous to go to a church who sing more than they pray. And there is no oil in the song. Hallelujah.
No oil.
Today, I want to take you to unfamiliar territory.
Jesus.
No. God told me, say, when you cross over from darkness to light, you have engaged in a warfare. There is no substitute for it. You can't run away. Hallelujah. The day you receive Jesus Christ, a battle started. If you are not a fighter in a kingdom, you can't be a winner. This is the bottom line. I'm taking you to unfamiliar territories. Hallelujah. Today I was talking to one of my daughters. He said something that I meditated. He said, she has been bombarded with the devil on his health and that. And he had a vision, a division. He said something told him, go and find the circumstance that surround your birth. It is called revelation. Once revelation comes, victory has started.
That's
so. Well, also for. The most dangerous thing that can happen to a soldier is when your bullets are not landing on target. Your enemies will finish you. The fact that you are praying does not mean you are on target. You need revelation. You do a Kenya, you go and wee. Go and back, go and back. Some people can't sit down to hear the word of God. You can go to saloon for 6 hours. I went to a saloon somewhere. I don't know where I went to mama. They were doing some rasta. The rasta is very tiny. Then I thank God I'm a man. I look and say, how many months are they going to finish doing this one? Small one. So they count the hair. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They start plating. I begin to realize that it's a blessing to be a man. Because if I'm a woman, I'm going to sit down to do all this rasta. Hallelujah. You can shave your hair and be preaching. Amen. It's not easy. Hallelujah. Yeah. You can't sit down and hear the word of God. Today I'm taking you to unfamiliar territory. Every witch in your family, today they have the last day to leave.
Amen.
I am going to deal with unrepentant enemies. There are some people who wear ties so sad. As long as they are alive, you are not going, you are not moving a step. Today the battle will end.
Amen.
It's a choice. Hallelujah. Warfare. There is no escape route. You say you have received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You are the target of the enemy. What is the circumstance that surrounds your birth? What is the circumstance that surrounds your marriage? I am going to engage you in a spiritual warfare for your uncontested victory. That the devil will look at you and start crying. May the Lord disappoint the talkings of your enemies. Your loudest army will determine where you are going. Satan is using witchcraft to hold the whole world in ransom. Let me tell you this. There is a principality. There is a power. There are rulers. There are wicked spirits in high places. They are in the spirit. But they work with witchcraft. So none of them can get access to you. Most presidents that were killed, they were assassinated by their aide-de-camps. A man's enemies are the people of his own house. Hallelujah. I'm going to take you to some dimensions and open up some things to you. That there is a reason behind your suffering. There is no smoke without fire. Until you discover the key, you stand behind the door. Amen. Hallelujah. I say, until you find the right key, you stand behind the door. Gates are for access. Gates are for what? Access. So without a key, you may stand in front of the door with your blessing inside, but lack of access will still deny you. What must I know that I don't know, dear Lord? Is there anything you should know that you don't know? It's the bottom line. Don't live your Christian life in just, I'm praying, we are looking at what God will do. No. It's time to sit down and say, enough is enough. Enough is enough. No, I'm tired of this thing. Hallelujah. Yeah. Enough is enough. You are dealing with issues. Now, listen to me. Let me tell you this. Don't serve God because you are afraid that something is going to kill you. Your service to God must not be afraid because something is pursuing you. Serve God because you love Him. And leave the battle for Him to handle it. Today, I picked this in the bathroom. The Lord said, many are serving me because they are afraid of something. It should not be the key to serve God. Amen. Hallelujah. That is someone who called anointing service crowd. Bring this in crowd. People's attitude can. I asked God a question. That was His answer. Many are serving me because they are afraid of something. Some are serving God because they want a job. No. This is it. Okay, if you come to church because you want a husband, after you get it, what else? Don't serve God because you are afraid. Don't serve God because the doctor told you something you didn't want to hear. Don't serve God. Now, let me tell you something. Can I tell you something? Anything the doctor will tell you, it has been there before you saw it. It is God who has kept you. This is the bottom line. Whatever they saw, God has seen it a long time. Serve God. Because you love Him and you believe in His word. He that cometh to God must believe that He is. He that cometh to God must believe that He is. He is whatever you call Him to be. If you say He is your healer, He heals you. He is your provider, He provides. He is your banner, He fights. He that cometh to God must believe that He is. He said, Moses, tell them that I am that I am. I am whatever you call me. You can't describe God. He said, what is your name? You can't give God a name. No. You can't give Him a name. So He said, tell them I am that I am. I am whatever you call me to be, I am. Yeah. God is too big to name Him. Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. No. Amen. David looked at God in Revelation and said, what is man that you are mindful of him? When I look at you, I don't even know why you are so concerned about this man. Do you really need man? Wow. Revelation will put you on top. You see, there is something this week you must conquer. There is something you must conquer. There is a particular thing happening in your life that you must conquer. A lady sent me an email. based on the agreement prayer on Friday, God has started moving. Let me show you. He said, I thank God for using you and your ministry to reach me and my family, Papa. On Thursday, you asked us to write our greatest need and bring it to all night on Friday. I email my greatest need is to have a healthy daughter. And he already in bracketed the name called Inshra in 2021. If you get pregnant by this time, 9 months, we are in February. Manko school, minya mass in February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October. So I got about October, it should be delivered. So he said you need a child in what? 2021. That is not a testimony. Now listen. During the all night, I wrote again on a piece of paper. Agreement prayer. Lord, my prayer is to have a daughter in Shira this year, 2021, in Jesus' name. And I sent it. On Saturday, he sent the prayer point on Friday. On Saturday, he was not feeling well. What kind of thing is that? Went to hospital, according to they say, do pregnancy test. Kusidivisia. Behold, I took a pregnancy test and it was positive. And it comes after I've lost 3 pregnancies and lost a fallopian tube. This is the miracle. She lost 3 pregnancies. Lost a fallopian tube between Friday to, we are not asking when the husband fired. It's not important to God. Between Friday to Saturday, she was pregnant. You say God is not there. Don't serve God because you are afraid. Testimony. Somebody didn't even think about it. Some people don't even know what they look like. I'm sure some people wrote permit cream and put it there. That's agreement. But if you don't know where you're going, you will never get there. She was specific. I need the girl. He has already named the girl Isra. She has not tested whether the girl is a boy or girl. He has already confessed that the boy is going to be a girl.
Amen.
Is anything too hard for the Lord? No. Agreement prayer. You know what he did? I have not finished that. The moment he saw it, he came to write another agreement prayer and sent it again. Lord, thank you for the pregnancy. I am now going to agreement with my father prophet and I say, let me carry it successfully for 9 months. This is it. God bless you and your ministry. Hallelujah. Do you know what the Lord told me? He said that continue the agreement prayer throughout the year. When God answered the one you have put there, put in another one. This is it. If God has not even answered that one, there's a pressing one that has appeared. Put in another one. I'm going to do what I call agreement prayer, act of the testimony. Enter into agreement. It means that his spirit picked up the faith of what I was talking about. I was in a bathroom where sometimes I pick a lot of things in the supernatural, and the Lord said that. Last Friday, I told you at the honor, the Lord said, go back to the faith message. So I decided I'm going to preach faith. And if you don't take care, I'll preach faith for now to the end of the year. But today he came to me and said that, go and deal with the spirit of Jezebel. Now, it has wrongly been described. When I was growing up in the faith, young Christian, we thought Jezebel was a woman with a French name. How many of you believe? Yes. We thought when a woman do makeups and it's not, it's a Jezebel. Hallelujah. One of the ways the devil can deceive you is to present something in a different picture from the way it looks like. If the thing is white and the devil can call it black and you can accept the white as black, you are deceived. And listen, I told you on Sunday that the greatest attack of the devil is your mind. The weapon he uses is deception. So when the devil comes after you, he attacks your mind, and the weapon is what? Deception. I am not going to go into details to talk about what actually Jezebel did. Everybody knows. I can give you a little bit of them. He married to a president, very terrible woman. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, if you can go to the book of Kings and read about him. Hey, serious one. He killed Naboth and took out the vineyard that was for generations. So when you are dealing with a Jezebel spirit, you don't have inheritance. Naboth said that the vineyard is for my forefathers. I didn't even buy it. So it's not something I can sell it. It's something we transfer. When you are dealing with the spirit of Jezebel, they deny you of what they transfer in your hand. Number two, the spirit of Jezebel is a killing spirit. And it kills those who are marked by God to use them. This is it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Now, let me tell you this, another thing before I start. Don't ever deceive yourself when you are dealing with a Jezebel spirit. I am not going to talk about the spirit. We'll deal with that way, but I'm going to, you know, everybody knows about it. Now, look at something about the Jezebel spirit. Jezebel has over 900 and something fetish priests. Now, you can never be a fetish priest without becoming a witch. It's not possible. So anytime you meet anybody like that, he practices witchcraft. It's not something you can, it's like prostitution. Sometimes you can't be a prostitute without practicing witchcraft. It is not easy for a woman to stand by the roadside, pick a man you don't know, sit in his car and go to his room and sleep with him. You must have a third eye. So there are some things you can't do it with your natural eyes. You have lost your mind. So nobody can be a successful fetish priest without practicing of witchcraft. Now, Jezebel, if you remember the encounter with Elijah on the Mount Carmel with the prophet of Baal, all the prophet of Baal, plus Asherah, all of them eat at Jezebel's table. So Jezebel actually feeds witches. She makes sure they live to fulfill their assignment by attacking the covenant people of God. So Jezebel, the Bible said that 900 prophets of Baal, they eat at Jezebel's table. It means that there is a caterer that cooks for them. And Jezebel pays for it. Are you following me? Hallelujah. So there is a wicked person in your background that somebody is paying and feeding to complete, to fulfill the witchcraft. This week something will end. I said this, if you get aggressive, something will end. The saddest thing, Agatha, is to, I watched something very interesting. You know, sometimes the way they put the thing, I don't know what it was a movie. Hallelujah. Amen. Was it yesterday that we were watching, me and mommy watched a movie yesterday together. It's like two women, suddenly there was a wine. I don't know whether it was wine, a drink, they came to the, and one drop something. The other was not looking, but he dropped something in the drink. But the other one turned. I didn't see her, saw that the other woman has dropped something, but he changed the glass. She took the woman's glass and put it there. The other woman drank the thing that gave to them. Immediately, he fell down and collapsed. It means that if the other woman took it, that was what's going to happen to her. The most dangerous thing that ever happened to you is to work with somebody that pretend they love you but they want to kill you. Yes. And you are not aware of it. And you don't have any revelation about how to handle it. The most dangerous. Let me tell you something. This Christian journey here, you must work with revelation. When we talk about discernment, it has nothing to do with somebody's attitude towards you. No. Somebody can be very hostile and has a certain attitude towards you. It does not necessarily mean that the person is a threat. It is as a result of his poverty problems and confusing the guy that disappointed them, that sometimes when they get an opportunity, they want to download their Zoom Lion Baller on you. But there is another person that is hugging you with sword in his body and with bomb in their body. Now, this is it. Discernment doesn't deal with the person's character. It goes to their spirit. It means that when you have the spirit of discernment, you have advanced knowledge about the things they intend to do. It has nothing to do with the way the person. So if you don't take care, You rather hate people that are not harmful. And you entertain people that are dangerous. So, some of you think that you have discernment. You don't have discernment. What you carry is not a discernment. It's suspicion. Oh, if you are clapping for Jesus, you will get something here today. Are you getting what I'm talking about? There's a difference. I have to go into details, but that's wrong. I don't want to divert from my message. So, there is something you are carrying you think is discernment, but it's suspicion. No. Sometimes it's based on what you have heard. So this lady came to tell me something about her, and then based on what I've heard, I started a certain attitude towards her. And if you demonstrate something I don't like, then based on my attitude, I suspect her, but that's only you have discerned. Because listen, let me show you discernment. Nothing shows like Judas is a threat. But Jesus picked it. Nothing. There was no physical thing. Judas is coming. Now, in fact, when you come to the apostolic team, you might even say that Simon is a threat than Judas. She rebuked his master, don't die. She was very loud and cocky. Everything you would talk and try. Judas was a very quiet type standing there as the treasurer of the team. But Jesus said, the one that I will dip the blood and share it together. He is the one. Interestingly, Judas even betrayed Jesus with a kiss. He came, master, and the kissing was the betrayer. So not everybody kissing you. Ayakatoya. It's a young girl here. No! He betrayed Jesus Christ with a kiss. He could have stand somewhere and said, I pointed to Jesus. When he came, they told him, the one I will kiss. So discernment has nothing to do with subscription. This generation don't understand the operations of the gift of the Spirit. No. No man know the thought of God except the Spirit of God. No man know the thought of man except the Spirit of man. So the Spirit of man knows your thought. Now that means that if you have a wrong thought towards me, it's my spirit that must discern it. So the discernment of spirit has nothing to do with the person's attitude towards you. He may be hostile, but it's not harmful. And there's a one that appears very romantic and nice, but it's dangerous. And that one, you need the discernment to pick it up. One day Nehemiah was burying the wall, and then Sambalat and Tobias tried all their means. Finally, they decided they would kill him at the church, and they went through by the means of a prophecy, and they gave a prophetic word. Nehemiah picked it by discernment and said that this thing they spoke, God didn't speak it to them. And he said that they are trying to use fear for me to go so they will kill me. He said, should a man like me be afraid of things like this? So he discerned that even though the angel of darkness has appeared like light, he's still darkness. Now listen, hey, girl, without discernment, you will never know a wolf in a sheep's skin. Give the Lord a clap of when I'm preaching. You will never know. No. Get this thing very clear. So, continue my message. Let me tell you something. Jezebel feeds 900 fetish priests. He gives them food. He does that. Hallelujah. There are still evil people in your family that are being sponsored by other people. Other people. They are still evil. So, he feeds them. Now, this is the thing. Let me show you the thing. Let me show you the spirit of Jezebel. So that you, if you are dealing with one thing in your background, by the time I finish today, tomorrow, and we start the dry fasting from Wednesday, you will understand that you know. Because revelation will put you on top. Now, watch this. Now, the fetish priests and all those guys that Jezebel feed them, they were the ones that demonstrate satanic spirits and all kinds of things that shows that this is what Jezebel stands for. Elijah managed to kill all of them. Do you understand? It means that if Persephone is a very obeyful man and he has some fetish priests around him, that he called them, these are the source of my power. After killing those people, you expect him to be weak. You didn't get what I said. If one of the fetish people around Pastor Asian is this one, they give him power, this one, yeah, you'll be a fetish priest for 1 minute. And these are the ones giving him power. And you know that these are the powers behind this man. After you kill these powers, will you be afraid of this one? Because these are the powers, these are the ones that he's feeding. Are you getting the point? But watch this. Elijah succeeded in killing all the prophets of Baal, but Jezebel threatened him and he ran. Are you waking up now? Now, it doesn't matter. So listen, when you are dealing with the spirit of Jezebel, killing his fetish priest is not enough. Some of you have killed the fetish priest of the spirit of Jezebel in your family, but the spirit is still intact. That's what we are going to do this week. So when it comes to killing of Jezebel, now listen, every Elijah can create what I call a darkness and light competition and call that the God that answered by fire, let him be God, and kill the responsible fetish priest for who stand for darkness. Are you getting it? And kill it. But when it comes to Jezebel killing, you need a specific anointing. So I submit to you that there is something you are dealing with in your life that is not moving. You have not gotten the right anointing. You have not gotten the right anointing. There is an anointing that you need. Jezebel threatened Elijah, outstanding prophet. This is a prophet that called fire from heaven. This is a prophet that locked the heavens for 3.5 years. There shall not be rain or dew, not because I pray, but according to my word. James wrote it and said, Elijah was a man subject to life passion as we are. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain for 3.5 years. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain. So he regulated the climatic condition by his prayer. Jesus Christ, I feel like preaching. Is somebody understanding what I'm talking about? He just shut up the heavens by prayer and opened the heavens by prayer, and he shows you the power of prayer. And do you know something? The way James put it, like he said that he was subject to life past. It means that he has constipation. He has weakness. He has short forth. It means that your weakness shouldn't cause you to be prayerless. Man, your falling and your weakness and your defeat and whatever you go through does not give you the right to be prayerless. Elijah was a man subject to life passion. He was a man who can call fire, but he was afraid. He was a man who can call fire, but he was complaining. He has constitution. He has weakness. He has all the shortfall. But that is not the right for him to become prayerless. No. He prayed more earnestly. And he used the prayer life to regulate the heavens. So God said that, I wish I can send rain, but Elijah has shut it. Today God gave me a scripture and we were meditating, we were thinking, come and let us reason together and say that, submit yourself to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. And the Lord emphasized something that shocked me. He has never told me. Say, I didn't say the devil will flee from me. He will flee from you. Wow. Tomorrow, I'll go to details for that. God told me, you resist the devil and the devil will flee from you. I didn't say the devil will flee from me. Some people go to God and ask God to do something for them that they have power to do it. Let me go to phase two. Maybe let me say point two if you understand it. That means that it becomes faithless. Hear this. It becomes faithless when you are still praying on something God has already released the answer. I'll come back to point one, repeat it and say point three. Number one, it is useless for you to go to God to ask him to do something that he has already empowered you to do it. So you submit yourself therefore to God. You resist the devil and the devil will flee from you, not God. So because the devil must flee from you, then it doesn't make it any way for you to go and think that God must resist the devil. Because God said that the devil must not flee from me, he must flee from you. There is no problem between me and the devil. When it comes to the devil, the rankings are set. But when it comes to you, you are forgetting where you stand. So you want me to resist what you must resist. And so when you resist the devil, he flees from you. He doesn't flee from God. God is omnipotent and almighty. He talks to everybody. In the book of Job, he sat down and communicated with the devil. No. All things were made by him and for him. Sometimes he promotes you by using the devil. Sometimes he elevates you by using the devil. So there is something about God that he can use everything he created. Everything. Amen. Are you getting the picture now? So get this thing straight. Hallelujah. When it comes to Elijah called fire from heaven. Kidabatoya. Hey, pipa, pipa, pipa. One day there was a group of soldiers. He caught fire and consumed them. The fire set in the midst of the soldiers, burned their camouflage, their shoes, their guns, and killed all of them. Twice. He killed them. He caught fire and the fire came to leak water. In the history of the world and things God created, Elijah is the only one who managed to call a fire. The fire, every time water has power over fire. When there is a fire, we call water waste. But Elijah released a fire that drank water. The Bible said the fire that came down from heaven and consumed the sacrifice at the Mount Carmel. The Bible said the fire leaked the water. It has never been repeated again in the Bible. That fire is drinking water. This is the man. This is the man I'm talking about. The man that called fire that the fire leaked water. The Bible said the fire. When these people couldn't call their God to send the fire, he came and worsened the situation by saying that for you to know that you will not have any doubt about my God, fetch water into the sacrifice. Elijah wet the wood and shook it. It's not that the wood is just wet by sprinkling. There was a water statue inside the altar. And the Bible said when the fire fell, it licked the water. That same man heard the woman say that, may the gods do unto me. And likewise, if I don't make your life like one of the fetish priests you kill tomorrow by this time, that means that Jezebel gave Elijah 24 hours to leave, and Elijah ran. This is the spirit we are dealing with. Witchcraft, and Elijah ran. Hallelujah. Now, in the book of 1 Kings chapter 19, let me tell you something. Before I go there, Elijah ran away from the woman who he killed, the fetish priest around his life. That was over 900 and something. He killed all of them. But the woman's threat made her run away. So Jezebel is not a woman, it's a spirit. It's not a woman with a French nail. A man can be in your family with a Jezebel spirit. You can marry a Jezebel. You can court with a Jezebel. This is the bottom line. If you come to close to the Jezebel anointing and Jezebel spirit and you don't have an anointing, a target is to kill you. This is where we are going now. So some of the sicknesses we are dealing with in our generation, it is a Jezebel in which has metamorphosis itself in that particular angle. Anything that seems to kill and eliminate the children of God are a spirit of Jezebel. Number two is a spirit of control. It controls you. Every witchcraft is based on control. Hallelujah. So when we are dealing with the Jezebel spirit, it controls. Amen. Now, this is what the spirit does. What even the president couldn't do, Jezebel did it easy. The president of the country went to Naboth and said that, give me your vineyard because I love it. And he said, it's for my great-grandfathers, I can't give it to you. Jezebel came, his husband was sitting down depressed. Who is the president of the country? Asked him that, honey, why are you so down? He said, well, I wanted Naboth a vineyard, but he wouldn't give it to me. And he said, is that what you are trouble? Go and sleep, tomorrow I'll hand it over to you. And tomorrow he handed it over to him. He killed the man in cold blood. So you see, when you don't get anointed, what I'm going to talk about, your back can be a target of Jezebel. Your husband can be a target of Jezebel. Your business can be a target of Jezebel. And when somebody around Jezebel wants your thing, Jezebel will make sure you are not alive. Hallelujah. Are you getting what I'm talking about? Huh? So there is an anointing. That is what I want to introduce you to. Ah, Jesus Christ. There's an anointing for everything. There is an anointing. You carry some anointing, but there's something you're dealing with there. You have not gotten the specific anointing to deal with it. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth. How God, Acts 10:38. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. So even Jesus needed the anointing to survive. So there's an anointing you need. I said there is a specific anointing you need to deal with a specific problem. Hallelujah. So women need anointing to marry. The kind of man you have married, you don't marry him with a naked eye. You must be anointed. What is anointing? The endowment of the supernatural power of God over your life that causes you to do things that go beyond human understanding. Hear this very clear. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Samson carries a specific anointing. He carries a specific anointing for a specific purposes. That is why in the church there are apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That means that we all don't carry the same anointing. Amen. But there are other 9 gifts of the Spirit that is being released. The Bible says, are all apostles? No. There are diversities of gifts by the same Spirit. What is an anointing? Now, if you come to the place to know that as a child of God, you need the anointing to accomplish every great thing that you need to do, then you will not compromise your life on some things. I'm telling you something. All of them can be in the classroom learning normal. But when God decides to anoint this one for academic excellence, it does not matter how this one learns, he cannot match him. This one said, you need anointing. Are you getting what I'm talking about? It is what makes the difference. The anointing is what makes the difference. It is anointing that makes a difference. Nothing makes a difference. One day, I was reading the Acts of the Apostles. I went through back, and we hear the word that they were filled with the Holy Ghost. They were filled. Paul met Elymas, and he was trying to prevent the governor from hearing the word of God. And the Bible says, Paul, being filled with the Holy Ghost, said that you will not see the sun for a season. And instantly, so the difference between those who make exploit and those who couldn't make is that they were filled. Being filled means anointing has come upon your life. Are you with me at all? So that's what makes the difference. You need anointing to do some things. Sometimes, many years ago, the Lord told me something. I have picked prophetic things about nations, sometimes elections, sometimes about leaders of nations. But the Lord will tell me, pray about it, don't talk about it. It's exciting for God to show you something you go and talk about for everybody to clap. And one day God told me something, he said, because I have only revealed it to you, but I have not given you the defense anointing to handle it. Hear this. So it means that even among the prophet, not everybody can go national. Unless you go, it mixing it with the devil's spirit. But on a genuine anointing, it's not every prophet that deals with presidents. There are prophets, their prophetic anointing is limited to God's people. So there are specific anointings. Check all the prophets in the Bible. Check all of them. Some deal with kings, some stay away from kings. Some were just for the church. Hallelujah. John the Baptist didn't have the anointing to go and rebuke kings. When he tried, Herod removed his head. It was not his oil. No. It was not part of his anointing. No. Jesus Christ even walked on earth. He avoided them. The day Herod saw Jesus, he was so happy. But he never saw Jesus. Jesus avoided them. No. Don't try to get around kings if you don't carry that anointing. Stay away from me. I know my calling. No. There's an anointing for everything. Even if you don't have it, you must seek God for it. There is an anointing you need to do the business you are doing. There is an anointing you need to raise the children. So there are specific anointing for some things. Amen. Elijah can call fire from heaven, but he doesn't have the anointing to silence Jezebel. Elisha can carry double portion of Elijah's anointing. May he not dare Jezebel. Hey, can I tell you this? Stay away from things that God has not anointed you for. Stay away from it. You will shorten your life. When you come and see potency, it's an anointing. If God has not given to you, don't go and build one. No, 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 no. Some men of God, they have anointed to build universities. Don't just start one when God has never anointed you for it. No. Don't build a hospital when you are not anointed. You'll be the first to be admitted. There is an anointing for everything. I'm telling you, not everybody can marry a king. Not everybody can marry a pastor. You can be a nice, quiet, outspoken, gentle woman, but you don't carry that anointing. If you want to get there, they seek God to give you that anointing. Until God releases that anointing upon you, don't try. You must be convinced that this anointing is upon my life. Hey! The Lord bless the hand that are clapping. Are you hearing what I'm talking about? No. Can I add this one? That will confuse anybody. Not everybody has anointing to stay outside of his country. Bottom line. Some people will leave their country 1 year, they will make it. Some will go 40 years and come with $20. What you are doing, have you been anointed for? Even Jesus Christ, when the mother was pushing me, he said, Mama, my time has not yet come. It's not enough to be anointed. You know the timing. If you do the right thing at the wrong time, you still fail. If you do the right thing at the wrong time, you still fail. It is a right thing, but you did it at the wrong time. No. 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 Don't waste your time and go there and say, I completed Form 5. This lady has PhD. I can marry her. No. There are women and you need anointing to marry them. If you don't carry the anointing, they will never submit. If you meet a Queen of Sheba with all his accomplishment, his wisdom, nobody in the country is qualified to propose to Queen of Sheba until he met Solomon. Now he has met a man that is working in a higher anointing. The Bible says when he saw what Solomon was accomplishing, his spirit left him. Everything you build is a demonstration of your wisdom. Hear this. Anything you build is a demonstration of the wisdom, of the anointing of wisdom God has put on your life. Joshua at Ai stayed down there when Moses at the top of the mountain. And Joshua fought the battle. The progress, the victory, and the success of the battle depends on the hand lifted by his father. Watch this. So Joshua was a skillful soldier before God asked him to take the people to the promised land. But he needed Moses to lay hands and give him wisdom. It means that Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses has laid hands. It means that Joshua has other anointing, but he needed that one in addition. Because hear this, the mantle to carry the people from Egypt to the promised land was mandated and ordained by Moses. If he made a mistake and he failed, and even you have to succeed him, you will still need his hand. Hey! Be careful the way you say the man has lost his anointing. It may be what you need. Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses has laid hands. Apostle Paul said, I long to see you that I will impact upon you some spiritual gift. Not that God is going to do it. I am going to impact. So there's a realm of authority that God can give the man of God the power to release an anointing over your life. So the reason you have no marriage is that you have not received the anointing to deal with the anti-marriage spirit in your background. It's an anointing. It's an anointing. When you go to hospital, you hear the doctor say, does anybody in your family has so-so and so sickness? Immediately the doctor asks you that question. It means that you need a specific anointing to silence that thing. That means that the devil is trying to set a line that once you come from this background, you must have this sickness. So even medical science accept patterns in the bloodline. They believe in the negative patterns in the bloodline. I was doing a checkup and the doctor recently that was doing a checkup asking me questions that, do you smoke? And I said, mommy, you know I'm a pastor. He said, I know a lot of them who smoke. He told me. He asked me, do you drink? Do you that? Do you do that? Yeah. He was just doing. And I said, I have been in this job for some years. And I know pastors who drink. I know. He said, the greatest mistake we make is that we're going to do surgery and some of them, we thought they don't drink. And we thought they don't smoke. Because you see, when even you drink or you smoke, your anesthesia should be different for those who doesn't drink. Because one can say, I didn't be gumu de da. Many years ago, there was something mommy has to go and do. He has to be under some anesthesia. And then when he finished, they were trying to let him come. And I heard the nurses saying that way. Oh, yes, mommy, oh, no, sir. Oh, yeah, I'm fine. Mommy and corner will be my father because we were sorry. Because we know. And sacro on numbi. Then I realized that those who drink, they wake up quick. Huh? The fact that you are quiet means you are a suspect. I'm telling you. I'm telling you, yes, those who drink, they wake up very quick. Those who don't drink, you're warm at the end of a chance. I'm sorry. Because alcohol be an enemy. But also there, you are loaded. Amen. You can't eat it without. Do a lot of Christians drink? Hey! I'm not saying a lot of Christians. You! Ah! They don't want us to talk about it. Hey! Hey! It's a no-go area for preachers. Don't talk about it. I wrote 71 harmful things alcohol does in the Bible. I walked through the Bible, Genesis to Revelation. Came out of there. The first drunkenness was Noah. He drank and slept naked and cursed one of his grandchildren, Cana. Alcohol. It is alcohol that loves children use it to rape their father. Alcohol. Lord, they gave their father vodka. This one did it on Monday, the next one did it on Tuesday. And produced the Moabite and the Ammonite. So the Moabite are the descendants of a spermatosia between a daughter and a father. That is why for Ruth to appear as a Moabite and come in the genealogy of Jesus, number one, he must renounce his God and get special anointing to join the people of God. Amen? Are you there? You need a specific anointing. Don't deceive yourself. Everybody might not need anointing to marry, but not you. Where you come from, you need the endowment of the Holy Ghost to stay in a happy matrimonial home. No matter how you try your best to be a nice wife, the altars from your husband's background will not permit him to still live in harmony with you. They will never permit him to live in harmony with you. It means that for you to live in harmony with the man, you need an anointing. No. Some people, they will need a special anointing to pass an examination. NCCA, they've written and written and written until when the examiner see your thing, they don't even take their time to watch you. They just mark it after. You need an anointing. You need an anointing. What is this anointing you are talking about? I'm glad you asked. We'll come there in a second. You need an anointing to do specific things in your life. I am asking you that what you are doing now, are you anointed for? Have you been anointed to do what you are doing? Don't just open a saloon because somebody has opened it. Don't try to do the things that others are doing because they might be anointed for what they are doing. And if they are anointed for what they are doing, you don't carry the anointing, you will have what is called multiple failures, which is equal to frustration. I have seen people marry men that they should live at peace, but they are not. Because they don't carry the anointing to marry them. I'm telling you. Not every man can marry Queen of Sheba. No. His accomplishments and wisdom is too high. And your baby, your name, you are saying a bit more, no. Boy, your level is low. You know my level. Your level is low. I'm trying to tell you. For you to come up to that place, you must be anointed. You need anointing to carry the Messiah. The Holy Ghost will come upon you. It is a man. It's not going to be normal. The power of the highest shall overshadow you. It's not going to be normal. So the moment that statement came, Mary must be anointed to carry Christ. You need anointing. No! Without you, you will struggle for nothing. Now, what you hear people say, juju, mala, sorceress, divinators, when they consult, it is called satanic anointing. Because the devil forever created a counterfeit version of the original. So when somebody went to a juju man and come and sprinkle some concoctions in front of his shop so that they will buy his things and not buy your things, it means that he has contacted an anointing but from the dark side. Why is it so? Because, number one, the gift and the callings of God are without repentance. When God anointed the devil, God said that the devil is called the anointed cherub. So before he became the devil, she was called what? Lucifer. And he was the anointed cherub. How had that fallen? Oh! And so God endowed him with all kinds of qualities. Now listen, when he fell and rebelled against God, God couldn't pull the power back, but he get corrupted. He get corrupted. He get corrupted. He become a retired angel. Because whatever God gives to you, you must still stay connected to him for it to be journey. If this guy is preaching. If you disconnect yourself from God, then it gets corrupted. That is why people that used to come to church that stop, be careful with them. They win you into the world. One of the most dangerous people you can hang around is people who used to be Christians. Whatever pull them out of the faith, if you don't take care, they win you. Be careful hanging around a backslider. Be careful. Be careful hanging around it who has tested the powers to be. Apostle Paul said that those who have tested the powers, if they have to fall back, it's like a dog eating his vomit. That's the way the Hebrew writer explained it. So there is some witchcraft going on in your family. You must be anointed. And that is my assignment this week. Yeah. Hey! Some unrepentant enemy will be buried alive by this anointing. Yeah. What do I call them? Unrepentant enemy. It means Oma Riatasu so be debonair. There are enemies that, based on what hit them, they repent. But they are unrepentant ones. They are beyond stubbornness. They are beyond stubbornness. Stubbornness doesn't change them. They have just reacted, so say, as long as they live, your life must not go forward. Unrepentant enemies. And you do a special anointing. Hallelujah. A musician came to me and started talking about the fact that he doesn't know what is happening. Now he's abhorrent. God can say, girl, you are not anointed. Or you are losing the anointing. God can give you an anointing for one song that becomes popular. There is a price you need to pay to get the second song to be popular. And I told him, I said, listen, all the worldly musicians that play songs that storms the world like Michael Jackson, them, they carry another anointing. It's not from God, but it's an anointing. So for you to sing and for people to listen to the song and be caught up into the supernatural and get them closer to God, it doesn't come by skillfulness. No! Don't deceive yourself to think that you are number one when God knows you are number 100. It's a total deception. I am hungry for anointing. If you ask me now, prophet, are you anointed? I say, not yet. Because I'm hungry. I cannot tell. Because I've seen anointings in the Bible. So I can't call this anointing. You may call it, but not me. I told you, in the kingdom, you don't arrive, you only make progress. No. Yeah. Adam Neku sang something, 30-something volumes. 37 volume 1, volume 2, volume. Nobody knows him. Nobody knows until the oil came. When the oil came, the songs that others couldn't notice, all of them came to a lamplight. So what you need is anointing upon what you are doing. Without the oil, you are wasting your time. Some people in the ministry as a form of godliness, but they've denied the power. Paul says some preach for envy. And some preach to add pain to my wounds. It means that the motive behind the preaching is wrong. It's just a matter of time. It will fall. Time will tell. Get anointed. Amen. Don't play with it. If you understand the anointing, you will not play with your life. If you are fornicating, it means that you don't even understand the anointing. For you to go and lie in a bed for a man to sleep with who is not your husband, you don't even know where you are going. No. No. Some women, if they know this is where God is taking them, they wouldn't live the life they live. It's a mistake. You don't have the picture of your future. Sleeping with you in cars, coconut, everything, park in front of your house, sleep with you before you go and sleep. No, you don't have sense. No, you have lost your mind. I told you, I said that you can't have the picture of your future and misbehave. No, you can't. If God show you a revelation about what he's taking you to, there are some things you won't yield to it. No. Joseph didn't sleep in his Potiphar because he has a dream of where he's going. How can I do such a sin against the Lord? He connected the thing to God, not even Potiphar. No. You need an anointing. There is an anointing you need. Amen. Some people, there are some ladies in church this week, they need an anointing to break free from delays in marriage. Listen. They are promising everybody, every man's dream wife. But to be in a matrimonial home, it will take an anointing. Because of the source and the background where they come from. Oh, I'm going to say this one that is very strong. Some of you were $1 million or 1 million Ghana cedis in your bank account, it will take an anointing. Forget it. Your Bible even acknowledges that there's anointing for prosperity. I am the Lord that giveth thee power. That is oil to prosper. So not everybody will prosper by hard working. No, it can. It has to take oil. Mm-hmm. You need anointing. Amen. Watch this. Go to 1 Kings chapter 19. Let me show you something. I don't want to read too much. 1 Kings chapter 19. Let's read from verse number 15. And the Lord said to him, go, return to thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. Return to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael. To be king of Assyria. Now, Hazael, anoint Hazael. Hazael, hallelujah. Hazael is walking around minding his business. Heaven has located that he's going to be king at Syria, but he cannot sit in the throne without oil. So, Hazael is ordinary until the oil comes. This is an instruction of God to Elijah. And the Lord said to him, who is talking? God. And the Lord said to, so when you come to church and you see us do anointing service, we are commanded. We are not so sure the specific anointings that are coming, but as I put my hand in oil, something will come upon your life. Now hear this. Hear this. Fill that horn with oil. Fill that horn with oil. How long will you mourn for Saul? I've rejected it. You are wasting your time. You can more until you yourself, the prophet, you also pass away and come to be with me. Fill the home with oil and go to Jesse's house. I have chosen myself a man after my heart. And Samuel went there and called them. Jesse didn't bring his son, David. All of them passed in front. Samuel almost anointed the wrong king for God. Because Samuel didn't step into prophetic discernment. He was looking at stature. And that day, God make a very strong statement and say, you look at the outer, but I check the inside. These people look like they are kings, but their heart, they don't have a kingship heart. So I have rejected them. They appear like kings, but when I put them in the throne, they don't have a heart for it. You can look like you are called, but you may not have the anointing to handle God's people. These are things that you must have. Let me tell you something. I concluded something. I need that to go. I said, Lord, we need a lot of humility to progress in our work with you. If you don't take care, we will deceive ourselves to try to be something you have never made us. Never. He said, anoint his head. Put it there, please. And the Lord said to him, go, return. If you want to read a little further, let's come to verse number 12 and look at something. Verse number 12. After the earthquake, a fire, 13. This is where God was showing himself to Elijah. And it was so when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face with his mantle. The same mantle, verse number 14. Watch this. And the Lord said, I have been very jealous. And he said to God, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel has forsaken thy covenant. Jesus, throw down thy altars and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, that is another thing. That is another thing. Living in your word of the state of your mind. Can I make that statement again? There is a way you think, and you think that that is your world. When Elijah was walking around, he thought he's the only prophet left. Because you see, if you don't take care, you will deceive yourself to think that you are God's standard. And if anybody is not appearing the way you appear, the person has missed God. Watch this very carefully. Living in the context of the mental ideas and philosophy of your will. Listen to Elijah. I only, I am left. And they seek my life and to take it. So what he's trying to tell God is that Jezebel's spirit has killed all the prophets. And it was true. He killed all the prophets. Once you are a prophet of God, they will slay you. And now there's only one prophet left, and Elijah believed that they are threatening him. Watch this. Watch this. This is what you must understand. Look at it. Go to the next. And the Lord said to him, now God is going to answer. And God is going to solve some of the problems and change some of the philosophies and some of the ideologies and the state of your mind, the way you think. Go, return to thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael. Now, he started complaining about prophets, but God has a higher agenda. He started to complain about the killing of the prophet. God bypassed and did a bypass surgery and put that one. We'll talk about that later. But now, let me tell you my vision. Anoint Hazael to be king over Israel. Okay, number two. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shall thou anoint to be king over Israel. So Hazael must handle Syria. Jehu is going to handle Israel. Because Jezebel is in Israel. So both Hazael and Jehu are anointed. But Hazael doesn't have the anointing to kill Jezebel. So wait. Don't think because all of you come for ordination, your callings are the same. It might be the same man that poured the oil on your head, but the calling will not be the same. Be careful. And thou shalt anoint king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, shall thou anoint to be a prophet in your room. Not that I'm dethroning you because you have renounced your calling. You say, I should kill you. I should take you away. Now, look at it. That's why I'm saying that. Don't live in the context of your word. Buy from the man of God. What is God's plan? Elijah was not made to die, but he was calling for death. Let me say that again. Listen. When Elijah appeared, he was not made to die, but he told God that, I am not better than my brothers. Kill me and let me go. So, don't try to live in the context of your word. And don't make decisions under pressure. When you are under pressure, be careful not to make major decisions. And can I add another thing? Be careful what you say when you're under pressure. It can make God change his mind about you. Hear this. Anoint Elisha to be in your room. It means that whilst you are working, I've already created your successor. Hear this. And it shall come to pass. This is the purpose of the anointing. It shall come to pass. It shall come to pass. He that escaped the sword of Hazael. It means that Jezebel can go to Syria, but he will escape. Shall Jehu slay? Lord, they are not listening to me. Hear this. And he that escaped the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Jesus is Lord. As of God's love, come. He that escaped the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay. He that escaped the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. There is nowhere in the Bible that Elisha did this anointing service. Elijah didn't do it. Never. Elijah didn't anoint Elisha. Elisha got double portion by aggression, determination, and perseverance. But what God told him to do, he didn't do it. So, Jehu shouldn't try to kill Jezebel because the oil has not come. If God sent me to anoint you and I've not anointed you yet, don't even take because you heard from God, you can go ahead. I'm going to show you something. Elijah never anointed Hazael. He never anointed Jehu. And he did anoint Elijah. If Elijah anointed Jehu, then Elisha doesn't need to do. Now look at it. The hierarchy of the prophetic anointing is that the last sword that must handle Jezebel should be the prophetic sword. He that escaped, the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay. He didn't tell her the specific people who the sword has targeted. But he said there's a possibility of escape. That means that there is something that they can escape us and face our children.
Yes, sir.
Here. So it's not enough to pay heavy duty school fees. The children got to be anointed. They must understand the principles of the warfare. And they must know that it's not enough to be a dadaba. Because if your children doesn't suffer the things you suffer, then they become dadaba in the context of the hierarchy and the bloodline. Are you getting it? My children never went through the things I've been through. No. Never. 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 They don't even understand. If my son becomes a pastor, he can't preach the message I'm preaching. He doesn't even understand it. That is why you can't expect Joel Austin to preach about curses. Joel can preach it. She may read it. He might understand it. But anointed to preach it, it will be a theological message. Hear me. When you see a man coming from a background of 8 uncles and aunties, and biological father's children, about 9 to 12 of them, and raised by a mother alone, then I know what I'm preaching. One day, I was talking about when I didn't have a passport. My son Nana Kwame came to say, "Daddy, so your father never traveled with you?" Then I saw that he doesn't understand. It was to him a mystery. She was surprised at my father. Now, the father you were talking, I didn't even see him. "I don't understand why your father didn't travel with you." I didn't answer him. I left it. Then the Lord showed me that. That is why there are preachers you listen to. There is a particular menu and food they will serve. You will still eat that food, but it is not the nutrients you eat you need to survive. You need. Hear this. God couldn't raise an Egyptian to bring the Israelites into the promised land. If you check every environment that God does something in, the person he raised to deliver his people is from that environment. Mm. Moses was a Hebrew who was staying in Egypt and studied all the laws and the principles and idol worship of Egypt. The reason he must stay in Egypt and study is that he's going to confront those spirits to release his people. So you must have the both sides. So let me tell you something. There are things happening in our life and God is manipulating things. So for Moses to grow up in the palace and to go to Pharaoh's palace and know the things, when Stephen was preaching, he said, Moses learned all the wisdom of Egypt. That means that anything Moses must know about the idol worship and the witchcraft in Egypt, he knew it before he entered and said, let my people go. Now watch this. Watch this. In 2 Kings chapter 9, I'm reading from verse number 1. 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 1. Let's see the word anointing service really took place. And Elisha the prophet called one of the children of the prophet and said unto him, watch this. Get up your loins, Kadiba Satire, and take this box of oil in thy hand and go to Ramat Gilead. Go to Ramat Gilead. So Elijah, when Elisha was going, he has a school of prophets. There's a lot of prophets he was training, literally. Huh? So it's like, I've called any of them. And I said, now listen, if I take a bottle of anointing oil, are you getting it? And I call Pastor Asian and I say, Pastor Asian, go to Jackie's house and pour oil on his house and release anointing. Even though he's the one going, but I'm the one anointing. Ah. There may be different reasons for that. At the time Elisha was sending this prophet, he was a very old man. So maybe incapacitation about walking and movement was part of the things. But if a president writes a speech and give it to the vice to go and read, the vice president will read the speech. But whatever is come out of the speech, the president is responsible. So he's going to say that the president of the country was supposed to be here, but due to certain engagement, he couldn't come. He has asked the vice president to come. So whatever the vice president is reading, he's reading it on behalf of the president. So when you take the word of God and you start reading it, it is God speaking to you direct, because all scriptures are given by the inspiration. Hear this. Elisha the prophet called one of the children of the prophets. So one of the sons of the prophet. All these guys are sons of the prophet. All these guys you see around me, they are all sons of the prophet. Hallelujah. All of them. Anybody that is called by God and looking to me, as God lay on his heart, this is my father. He's a son of the prophet. He's a daughter of the prophet. So that's what it is. And even those of you who are sitting under the sound of my voice, watching me all over the nations of the world, you are sons and daughters of the prophet. And everything produces after it can. One of the reasons why I know you are going to make it is that you don't come from a background of depression. You don't come from a background of poverty. You don't come from a background of frustration. You come from a background that no matter the obstacle, you will soon break through. On the 20th wedding anniversary, I wrote something about my wife and I said that we have been through all kinds of things, but it has rather made us better and toughen us. It means that we have gone through all kinds of things, but at the end of the day, it has made our life better. And it's going to be the evidence of the sons and the daughters of the prophet. You cannot fail. You cannot be frustrated. No matter what comes after you, you will rise above that thing. You will run through a wall. You will live through a troop. And you will run through a wall. You will come from the ashes. And you will rise up from the dunghill and from the boiler. And you will be demonstrated like a trophy. It's just a matter of time. Sometimes you just look at the devil and say, my father is not a failure. I can't be a failure. I don't come from a blood hierarchy of failures.
I don't come from a blood hierarchy of frustrated people. My father don't look like a frustrated man. I can never be frustrated. Don't try to put on me something that is not my portion. I reject your sickness. I reject your poverty. I reject your confusion. And I reject your lies. Accept your background. Because I told somebody, I said, listen, if you are privileged to be part of this family, and this is your church, and you are sad to tell somebody you come from Portis, you are a fool, because it is foolishness to be shameful with that which is gainful. This is the bottom line. You have lost your mind. Something is wrong with you. Yeah. Because others celebrate things that are not close to this. So why not? If you don't know how to say I am, nobody can say thou art. It's simple as that. It is foolishness to be shameful with that which is gainful. I'm teaching. Hear this. I want to end. Tomorrow I'll continue. Hear this. And Elisha said, so Elisha called one of the sons of the prophet and put oil in his hand. Listen, and said to him, get up your loins and take this box of oil in thy hand and go to Ramoth Gilead. What am I going to do, daddy? And when thou comest thither, look out there, Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshah, and go in and make him arise up from among his brethren. Come back to verse number 1. Let me leave it from New Living Translation. Not everybody can understand King James English. Meanwhile, Elisha the prophet had summoned a member of the group of prophets. Get ready to travel. He told him, take this flask of oil, olive oil, with you. Go to Ramoth Gilead. And when you go there, and find Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, son of Nimshah, his father and his grandfather. Call him into a private room. So listen, sometimes some anointing services are private. There is a place that you must be able to find some seed. Walk to your spiritual father. If you have the opportunity, I want to come and see you. And then go there. And put the oil and say, daddy, pray for me. And just in case he forget, demand it. Sometimes I ask him, daddy. Sometimes I go to some of this. One day I was in a spiritual father's house. And he wanted to pray for me. I said, papa, is there no any oil here? He said, Nana, oil. Then he called the secretary. So there's oil in your troubles there. And I knelt down and he poured. So sometimes I demand it. There are times they will naturally be led by the spirit to pour the oil. But at times you demand. The Bible says, covet earnestly the best gift. So when it comes to spiritual gift, covetousness is not a sin. If you desire the grace that was on a man, do everything and covet it. Amen. And it's not a sin. No. Paul said, covet earnestly the best gift. So sometimes you need to, and say, call him to a private room away from his friends. So the prophetic father has seen that by the time you go, you'll be sitting with his friends. But that anointing, the friends must not see. So go there and say, excuse me, can I talk to Jehu? And then take Jehu. Huh? When you take Jehu, that's right. I almost have to, the man has called for his anointing. And call him to a private room. Listen to this. Call him to a private room away from his friend. And pour oil over his head and say to him, this is what the Lord say. I anoint you to be king over Israel. So what Elijah refused to do, God will not let Elijah rest. Because listen, the last sword is a prophetic sword. But if Jehu has not started killing for escape, he that escaped the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay. But at this time, Hazael has not started. Jehu has not started. As long as Jehu has not stepped into his anointing, Jezebel will still do party.
If you don't step into your rightful anointing, certain things in your background will never change. The poverty will never change. The hand to mouth will never change. The delays will never change. And the witches responsible for sickness will have a field day. Because you have not stepped into the rightful anointing. Elisha said, my boss didn't do this. But I see Jezebel is arising. Now, do you know something? There was a lot of confrontation between Elijah and Jezebel. But there was no one confrontation between Elisha and Jezebel because he avoided it. Now, avoiding the battle does not mean you have fought it. You are only postponing it. So listen. Confront what must be confronted. Confront it. Don't leave it for your children. At this time, the oil is there. And God knows that if this guy dies, he's going to make a mistake. Then he said that this is what. Pour the oil over his head and say to him, this is what the Lord said. I anoint you to be king over Israel. Then open the door and run off. Run for your life. It means that, listen, not all the anointing service you see us do is easy. Because there are people, when you take oil and you pour it on their head, you are trying to change them from what satanic word has decreed over their life. Hear this, girl. The lion's target is not David. The lion's target is for the sheep. But because David wants to defend the sheep, then the lion turned to David. So listen, some of us may not be the target of the powers of your background, but because we try to rescue you. I'm teaching. Look at verse 4. Watch this. So the young prophet did as he was told and went to Ramoth Gilead. Wow. When he arrived there, he found Jehu sitting around the other army officers. So when we go there, there were a group of army officers. And Jehu himself is one of the soldiers. Other army. And when you go there, there were people there who were in higher rankings than Jehu. So there are people in your background that because of the way they came, they said they will not accept your progress. So your anointing service must be private. What do you mean by private? When you are there and you come and hide there for 3 days, it's a private anointing service. Can I tell you this, honey? Sometimes Porter City is a hiding place. Because listen, the greater side of your life is the things you do that nobody sees it. It generates a blessing that when they contend with God, show them the red car. Where were you when he was fasting at Porter's? Now, if they knew it, they wouldn't have attacked you. But because they didn't see it, they think you are ordinary. The reason for the private anointing service is that the other military officers, you, the prophet, can die for anointing them. Because those people don't take for granted when the prophet pour oil on your head. So do it and run for your life. I'm an old man, I can't run. So you do it. Yeah. I can send one of my sons to go and dedicate a place for his own risk. He must be anointed. And he must be skillful to run. And he must get your speed. If you misbehave, they kill you, I'll come and bury you. Elisha didn't mix well. He said, call him to a private room. Good morning, says. Excuse me, military officers. And when you meet them, you can see their prophets because of what they wear. Can I tell something to Jehu in 5 minutes? I'll be back. And put him in a private room. Cause him to know that. Look at it. And when he arrived there, he found Jehu sitting around with the other army officers. I have a message for you, commander. Kaduma showed up. And he said, for which one of us? That means all of them are commanders. This is a danger. When he went there, he mistakenly thought Jehu was the commander. And he said, I have a message for you, commander. One of them answered, which one of us? It was a company of commanders sitting down. You don't pick one and anoint. It's not everything you do for every eye to see. Oh, come on. Come on. Sometimes secrecy is a key for survival. Do it in a private. Ah! Upe show too much. Sometimes secrecy is a key for survival. Make sure you are not prematurely exposed. You can be killed before your time. Make sure you are not in a place of trying to be popular when God wants you to be in obscurity. It's dangerous. That is what I'm telling you. Not everybody must do wedding popping, popping. It doesn't matter the amount of money you have. Who are you trying to impress? You have the money, you have the cars, you have the ghoulies, but your wedding must be office wedding. Because you need a private anointing. Hey, can I add this one? It's not every family you come from when you are traveling, you tell everybody. Yeah. So you are meaning I'm airport and a PM say pray. Man, who never you as a prayer too? A two in the we understand, but could do I see. I am telling you my side of the story. Accept it or leave it. That's all. Amen. This is a very serious one. I have a message for you, commander. He said, for which one of us? They will ask. For you, commander. You particular. It means that when they were there, there were a group of commanders that were there. So you don't pick one and anoint. It must be private. For you alone, commander. He replied. Look at what. So Jehu left the others and went into the house. And the young man prophet poured the oil over Jehu's head and said, this is what the Lord said. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anoint you king over the lost people, Israel. You are to destroy the family of Ahab. Simple. The purpose of the anointing is divine. If you are not clapping, you are not a child of God. It's divine. Give me the King James Version. Watch this. Watch this. And thou shalt smite the house of Ahab, thy master, that I may avenge the blood of my servants, the prophets. Bronsambi to feel we deal with too much. And the God of vengeance is about to speak from tomorrow. I said the God of vengeance is about to speak from tomorrow. Somebody say vengeance, 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 vengeance. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. I will repay, says the Lord. He said that I will avenge Kidaba, the blood of the servants of the Lord, and at the hand of Jezebel. Give me the New Living Translation. Look at, so the anointing is defined. If you don't carry that anointing, don't dare Jezebel. Please, stay away from trying to attack some people until a specific anointing has come. You are to destroy the family of Ahab, your master. In this way, I will avenge the murder of my prophets and all the Lord's servants who were killed by Jezebel. The entire family of Ahab must be wiped out. And the anointing. So listen. This is a kingship anointing in disguise. It looks like we are going to the Independence Square. It looks like we are going to inaugurate a king. But the secret weapon is that it's not just becoming a president. There is a family he must wipe out. So Ahab, Jehu's anointing is to finish the house of Jezebel. And if he succeeds in his ministry, by the time he finishes, not even a dog from that house must be left alive. Listen. Listen. There is a wicked spirit that has been in your father's house and your mother's house for years. I feel like preaching even though I'm ending. It has been an ancient spirit. It has been a very destructive spirit. It has caused men to live in poverty.
It has brought delay, setback, and limitation. But from tomorrow, an anointing is coming over there. The Jehu's anointing. Watch this. The entire family I have must be wiped out. I will destroy every one of his male descendants, slave and free alike. Anywhere in Israel, they must be located. And listen, listen. Because the thing is an anointing, if Jehu bypass you and you don't even look like Jezebel, the anointing will tell him that you are one of them. That is why you need an anointing. God said that every one of his descendants, slaves. So if you were a slave and you work in Jezebel's house, you have picked the spirit. Free alike. If you were a cook in Jezebel's house, God said you must not leave. Because you can't serve Jezebel without him impacting the spirit on you. Africa, our background is no good. I leave nobody here outside of it. Your chi and your papa are basem and ibre and toqua. Oh, yeah. Any the spirit that say you are never going forward. I saw something. A profound spirit in it said, Mami cried $10 million. The Bruni said, I'll show you the difference and tomorrow I'll go to the test. Where did he get the $10 million? How did he get it? And what wisdom did he use? I got to get the $10 million. And because of that, even if they don't like you, they don't mind becoming your friend. The attack is not because I love you. I want to find out how you got the 10 million. Africa say, 10 million I want. I don't also want you to have it. She may cheer through some they have to got it. Now, I'm going to explain it. This is it. I don't care what you think. I've preached a message today. Among the anointings you need this week is Jehu's anointing. Hey! Kaziva Satire. The entire family of Ahab must be wiped out. I will destroy every one of his male descendants, slaves and free alike. Anywhere in Israel. Watch this. I will destroy the family of Ahab as I destroyed the families of Jeroboam, son of Nabat, and of Baasha, and of Ahijah. Dogs who eat Ahab's wife Jezebel. Dogs. So it means that because of the wickedness, he must die a disgraceful death. Any wicked person in your family upon the mountains of destruction and the harm they've caused over the years, may they die a disgraceful death. We will leave no one ahead. Hey! There is a cousin in America that has suffered because of that spirit. There is a sister that has suffered. And you were supposed to be 10 times better than where you are standing. Adien Sayame Monyame Shrobo. Bibi versus son. I can see say Bibi better. Revelation has come. Something is going to happen. It's a week of release. It's a week of freedom. It's a week when the prison doors are open. It's a week where the bondage is coming out. The chains must be loose. The shackles must come off. The obstacles must be broken. The barriers must be dealt with. The valleys must be filled. The mountains must be level. It's a week of uncommon visitation. Lift your two hands, open your mouth and pray in the spirit. Whatever you heard in the preaching, pray in the spirit. release the Jehu anointing. I am not waiting for tomorrow. I need it now. Let tomorrow be a confirmation. Jehu's anointing.
God bless you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the message. For further inquiries, contact Well Prayer Center, P.O. Box GP21421, Accra, or telephone +233 274 00 9933 or +233 242 472655. Email us on info@portercity.com or visit our website www.portercity.com. Location Plot 16 Mutual Road, Pram Pram, Greater Accra, Ghana.